Hi, I'm often asked by readers of my book, since sleuthing people, that is, gauging their character and abilities, is so critical for investing, how does one do it? Well, learning how to understand people often takes a lifetime, and once you do understand it, it is often too late to do you any good. Or as the French say, si la jeunesse savait, si la vieillesse pouvait, if youth only knew, if old age only could. Luckily, there's a sweet spot in between when you can do both, if you use some shortcut methods. I'll mention here three such methods for sleuthing people, but always keep in mind that of all the mysteries in the universe, human beings are the ultimate mystery. You can never understand them fully. All right, I'll go to the first two methods quickly, then focus on the third, which will lead me to mention the stock that, in my humble opinion, could go a lot lower. Not a forecast, nor a short recommendation, just as a test of the method. Okay? First, the three methods are the Myers-Briggs classification, the agent-principal split, and the smart versus stupid categories. First, the Myers-Briggs categories. There are 16 of them, based on four variables. When I sleuth a company, I try to gauge which Myers-Briggs category each executive falls into. This often helps to see if each of them can do most good or most harm based on his personality fit in the job and the other personalities. As well, when I occasionally put a team together myself, even a student team, these categories help me match tasks with abilities on the fly and improve the team results noticeably. I'll do a clip about the 16 Myers-Briggs categories in the future. Second classification, this one is my own, whether the person is an agent or a principal. The difference? An agent acts to realize someone else's vision for pay and recognition. The principal pays others to realize his. Note though, the great majority of all people are agents, no matter the talent, intelligence, or leadership ability. That's because very few have an original vision that can galvanize others into action, which is the definition of a principal. Why do agents obey principals? Because all humans need meaning. So agents, the vast majority, usually get meaning from dedicating their lives to the vision of others who do have them. Please note, some of these others may be long dead. For example, the Pope is an agent of the dead principal who had started the church. John Scully was an agent for Steve Jobs' vision for Apple. So were the rest of Apple's employees. Napoleon's army was full of soon-to-die agents for Napoleon's vision of himself as emperor of the world. Now, how about corporate world? Well, large public companies, unless they are run by founders like Jobs or Bezos, are mostly run by agents, like Apple's Tim Cook, or General Motors' Mary Barra, or IBM's Jeannie Romerty. So when you sleuth such companies, it is critical to see whether all the executives serve the same vision, or whether some serve clandestinely visions of their own that clash with the corporate one. Indeed, when a company hires by mistake a visionary in a lower position, he or she can wreck the organization. Like the US Army hiring social justice warrior generals, which probably contributed to the US Marines' recent loss to UK Marines in the war games. Or alternately, Exxon, where BlackRock's social justice warriors on its board stopped Exxon drilling for oil, contrary to the company's mission, which will likely present another sort of opportunity in the future. More of it too in a future clip. Third and last of the three people sleuthing methods is smart versus stupid. Like agents versus principal, this too has nothing to do with IQ, honesty, or leadership, but it is still a key metric of people sleuthing for investors. The method was first proposed by Italian sociologist Carlo Cipolla and is based on a simple question. Does this person act so as to benefit or harm both himself and others? The potential answers fall into four types. Type one, a person who acts to benefit himself and others, i.e. a win-win person, is by this definition smart. Like Warren Buffett, Steve Jobs, Lee Iacocca, Hewlett and Packard, always smart but they were also value creators for themselves and others. Value creators. Type 2. A person who acts to benefit himself while harming others is a rascal. Napoleon, Genghis Khan, Putin, Bernie Madoff, all come to mind. All were or are value destroyers. Type 3. Someone who acts to benefit others even while harming himself unknowingly is a patsy. These are, for example, garden variety communists, Napoleon soldiers, the fish, the mark at the poker table, or Bernie Madoff investors. All are self-destroyers. Type 4. Type 4 are those who act to harm others even while harming themselves. These world destroyers are the truly stupid. Interestingly, Cipolla's theory says that stupidity is not correlated with any other attribute, and that there are more stupids around that you can imagine, everywhere. And while rascals are at least rational, so they can be deterred, the stupids are mostly invisible and so cause untold damage, even more than rascals sometimes. What of the patsies? Yes, they too will always be with us, but at least they only harm themselves, mostly by being fodder for rascals. Now, how does all this relate to investment opportunities? Most public companies are run by agents who are so well taught to adhere to the vision of others that they often fall prey to rascals' scam visions, which become socially accepted via the rascals' PR machine. And this often sets the patsies' companies up for a fall once true reality hits, as of course it must eventually. What are the investment opportunities here? There are two. First is to avoid patsies' common delusion and not invest in the current faddish scam. Second is to benefit from shorting the patsies' stocks. Here are two examples from the past and then the current one. The first past example, the Club of Rome. In the 1970s, a few dozen liberal economists, including one Nobelist, founded the Club of Rome to warn against the world running out of resources, based on some cockeyed computer model that did not even have price as a factor. I kid you not. However, a cool-headed Stanford economist named Simon offered to bet them $1,000 that they were wrong by taking the price of 10 commodities of their choice and betting they will be down over the next 10 years. The clubbers gleefully took his bet. But 10 years later, Simon was of course right, and the clubbers paid up. Simon offered to bet again, and they declined. Second example, peak oil. In about the same period, Canadian Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau, the father of the current PM, by the way, stupidly believed the Club of Rome's propaganda that oil was running out and encouraged oil companies to drill the polar ice caps for more oil via tax benefits. Many corporate patsies took him up on it. In particular, a large Canadian company named Dom Petroleum did. But sadly, it went bankrupt as oil fell from 100 to 20. So did a few other patsy oil companies, as did many patsy investors, all of whom fell into the trap of believing nonsense just because it was socially popular. Now for the current example. Global warming, recently renamed climate change, is very likely a similar faddish scam. At the recent COP26 conference in Glasgow, a few world corporations created the First Movers Coalition, whose aim is to battle global warming, reduce carbon footprint, stop drilling for oil, and listen to this, create the market demand for zero carbon, which of course means there still isn't any. So now for the crux of it. One of the most enthusiastic founders of this group is Cemex, Cement Mexico, CX symbol. Like all big international companies, Cemex is run by people who feel they must adhere to the local beliefs to keep their job. Only in this case, in my humble opinion, they are doing what the Club of Rome did, and they too will likely pay the price for it. CX stock is now at about 650, down from 9, but the cyclical low is about 250. If the theory of stupidity applies here, as I believe it does, then CX stocks is likely to fall again to 2 buck or 2 buck 50, probably in a year, as the economy slides. In fact, if CX does fall below 250 in the coming economic downturn, it could then become a buy before it goes back to 5 or 6, once the Fed prints again in a panic. Of course, I could be wrong. So let's revisit it again next year to see if, politics aside, the theory of stupidity called this one correctly. Just as a test. That's all for today. Please let me know in a comment below what you think of the above. Give it a like. Subscribe to the channel. Tell all your friends that they're subscribed to. I'll see you next time. And meantime, thank you very much for watching.